Hello and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be looking at specific heat capacity. So for this particular video, we're going to go into a short, sweet definition of what specific heat capacity is and how you can use it to calculate heat in some very common type of problems that you'll use in introductory general chemistry to how to use this value. So whenever specific heat is used, this is always something that is referred to as the amount of heat required to increase something by 1 degree Celsius. Now, when we're raising that temperature, this is for 1 gram of a substance. So specific heat is unique for every single material that you would come across in the lab or with your in your home. Every single thing takes so much energy to heat up. So the way that I like to look at this is, think of it as there are numbers that are assigned for these. These are things that have been measured within laboratory settings. And the whole idea is, if I look at both of these two substances, I have water on the right hand side, I have iron on the left. So what exactly will it do? So if I apply, let's say, the same amount of heat to both, well, which one's going to heat faster? So one way to think about this is, if you put, let's say you put water on the stove to make, let's say, pasta or rice, or you're just trying to boil it to eat. And one thing you're going to realize is like, oh man, this is taking so long. I just want this to boil faster. It usually can take anywhere from 5 to maybe 15 minutes, depending on your stove. It takes a very, very long time for that to boil. And that's because it's absorbing all of that energy from the fire in order to eventually reach boiling. So now, if you can look here, water has a specific heat of 4.186, and that's joules over grams per Celsius. So the amount of joules, so 4.186 joules, is required to heat up 1 gram by one single degree. Okay, so that's a lot of energy for each time. Now, you don't usually just put water directly on a stove. Sure, maybe in a laboratory setting, you might put in a beaker. But at home, usually the way that you cook things is using like maybe cast iron pans or maybe aluminum pans, some sort of metal you're applying directly to that, to the burner. Now, when you put that on the burner, does it get hot quickly, right? So at first it's very cold, but within probably about 5 to 10 seconds, you can already start feeling the heat getting absorbed within that piece of metal, right? And now you can really see that with that lower value here, right? 0.451. That's a lot less energy that's required to heat that up. So it's going to be a lot less effort for the heat to be able to do that. So that's kind of the idea here of what we're going to be looking at. So let's go through the equations. We'll do some examples, and we'll show in this video, I'll show what kind of practice problems that you will see with specific heat. And if you like what you see, hit that like and subscribe button, comment below. And if there's any other future videos you'd like to see as well. And let's go take a look at this type of problem as we move through this. So when it comes to calculating heat, generally in introductory chem, there's two equations that we'll see. This video will cover just one, which is the mcAT equation. So for all my pre-meds out there, mcAT is an exam one day you'll have to take. So this is one way to easily remember how to use this. So you see the mc delta T, think mcAT. So how can we use this? Well, let's go over what each of these letters mean. So when we see the letter Q, this is referring to heat, which is a form of energy, okay? So now that energy value is, we're gonna be measuring that in joules. So if you think of joule like the vape pen, it's not the same spelling, it's joule as in J-O-U-L-E-E as the for the unit, right? This is the SI unit for energy. So we have joules. Now we have M, which you've seen in many different probably chemistry videos all over the internet. That is our mass, right? So we are going to be measuring that in grams. So we have joules is equal to grams. Now C, this is our specific heat, right? Where do we get specific heat from? Well, it's the specific heat capacity. So that capacity part where that C comes from, that is what that is for. So the units for that are joules over grams by Celsius. So you can already see that the grams are going to cancel between mass and the specific heat. Okay, so a lot of times when we talk about specific heat, we'll abbreviate that as SH, just so that way we're not having to constantly write what that value is. Now, delta T, this is our change in temperature. Okay, so when we talk about delta T, this is always about the final temperature minus the initial. Okay, so this is a little formula for yourself. If you see a delta, that's always final minus initial, and that's going to be reported in units of Celsius. So Celsius is going to be used in this calculation, and this is generally what our units are reported in. So let's take a look at this. Now, when we are using this formula, there's usually two types of problems that you will generally see when you are doing these types of calculations. The first one is usually you're calculating the amount of heat that is required either to heat something or to cool something down. So heating is generally, it will be a positive value when you are heating it for your Q value. So your joules will be positive, or that's endothermic. If it's a negative value, that's referring to exothermic, or it's releasing heat, right? So sine is going to be really important in these calculations. So you always want to make sure you're paying careful attention. Now, the second type of problem is identifying an unknown metal or substance. Being that specific heat is unique for every single material, we can use this to identify things. So let's try to take a look at each of these problems, so that way we can get an idea of what it is that we're going to be seeing with them. All right, with calculating specific heat questions, the big thing about these, they tend to be word problems, meaning that we need to make sure we are very organized in how we are writing all the little pieces that are in a problem. So let's take a look at this one. So it says, how many kilojoules of heat are lost? Okay, so right off the rip, it's telling you exactly what it is that we are trying to find. So we can see how many kilojoules of heat are lost. So when that is happening, that tells you that this is what you are trying to find, which is our Q value here, right? So Q, we're going to put a little question mark next to it to let us know this is what we're trying to find. Now it says, when the body temperature of a surgery patient with a blood volume of 5,500 milliliters is cooled. Okay, so now we have another volume that's here. We have 5,500 milliliters of blood that is here. Blood is mainly made up of water, so we can assume that this is the same equivalent as water. We're using a health example, being that there's a lot of health people that watch this as well. So we will have to use that density there to convert to grams because we will need a mass. So maybe let's, before we get too far into this, let's write our mass down here. So being that it's 5,500 mLs, we can convert that using the density that was given. And then we can see mLs cancels mLs. And this is equivalent to 5,500 grams. All right, let's take a look at what else is given in the problem. So the next thing that is mentioned is that we had that this is being cooled from 38.5 degrees C to 33.2 degrees C. So we have these two temperature values that are right here in the middle of the problem. Now, reading these careful is very, very important because we need to make sure we are identifying them properly. So we have TI, which is where you're starting, your initial point. And this is referred to as 38.5 degrees C in the problem. And in the end, it says it goes down, or we cool the patient down to 33.2 degrees C. So what we're going to have to do is use this to get delta T. So being that we're going to be using that mcAT equation from earlier, so delta T is final minus initial. So if we take 33.2 minus it by 38.5, what we are going to get is 5.3 degrees C when we do the final minus initial, okay? Now that we have all of our pieces here, what we can now do, and we also have our specific heat as well, so I already highlighted that earlier, we can plug in all these pieces into our equation. So we're trying to find heat, right? We have our mass, which is 5,500 grams. We are going to multiply that by the specific heat, which is 4.186 joules per grams by C. So I'm going to highlight kind of where all these are coming from. So this first specific heat is the blue value here. We have our mass that's being placed in here. And then our last but not least, we have our temperature, which is at negative 5.3 degrees C. And we will highlight that as well. We'll highlight that with purple. Okay. So, and let's move this over so that you guys can see this equation, because I'm kind of blocking that a little bit. Okay. So we have all of our values here. So what we will do is take 5,500 grams, times it by 4.186, times it by negative 5.3. And what we will get in the end is a negative Q value, which is going to be in joules. And we will get -122,021.19 joules for our answer. Now, is this really the way that you want it? Well, earlier it mentioned we want this in kilojoules. So how do we convert this number to kilojoules? Well, if you kind of think of kilo, right, there's 1,000 joules for every 1 kilojoule. So we can do a little conversion here for ourselves. And we can also round it to the correct number of sig figs in the problem, right? Because it looks like we had 3 sig figs throughout the problem. So in the very end, it's going to be negative 122 kilojoules is going to be our final answer here. And let's double check that our sig figs are correct. We have 3 sig figs for all the temperatures. We have 2 sig figs for the volume, so we do need to round this a little bit more. So this will be 120 joules because of significant figures. There are 2 sig figs for the volume. Okay. So we always got to do our significant figures in every problem. If you need help with that type of stuff, you can refer back to my sig fig videos. Let's find out the identity of an unknown metal. You found a 125 gram old cooking pot and added 14,600 joules of heat to raise the temperature from 22 degrees C to 325 degrees C. What is the identity of the old cooking pot? So you want to know, what is it made out of, right? Do you want to know, is it something that's worth keeping? So one thing that we're going to do here is we're going to list out all of our important values. So the first thing that we see is that we have a mass of 125 grams. We have a heat value that is hidden in this problem as well, right? It's 14,600. So that is a Q value. So 14,600 joules. And we have 2 temperature values. So we have a TI of 22 degrees C. And then we have a TF of 325 degrees C. So, and just to kind of highlight where those 2 values came from, that was from right here in the problem. So now that we have all these different values, the one thing we got to see is, well, what are we missing is our C value, right? So we want to figure out what the identity is. And generally with these type of problems, you commonly see them on exams when it comes to introductory chem. And we usually get a whole entire list of different values that you can use here to try to identify what it is. A lot of times this might be a multiple choice question too. So maybe if you can take your luck at guessing, but you should know how to do these, right? You want to get all those points. So if we have our Q equation, what we will have to do is rearrange it to get C by itself. Now, being that MC delta T are all being multiplied, what we can do is divide out M and delta T to cancel them to get C by itself. So when we do that, we can see mass cancels mass, and then delta T cancels delta T, getting us our formula of Q M delta T is equal to C, okay? So now what we're going to do with that equation is we're going to plug in all of the values that we were given in the problem. So we can see that we have our 14,600 joules. We're going to be dividing that dividing it by our mass, right? So that was 125 grams. And then we will also be dividing by delta T, which is our final minus our initial. So we have our 325 degrees C, and that's going to be minus 22 degrees C. Okay, so now when we plug in all these values, we have 14,600 divided by, and one thing I always recommend to all students is when you're using your calculator, use parentheses to your advantage so you're not giving the wrong answers when you are using your calculator. So it'll be divided by 125 times 325 minus 22 degrees C when you are plugging that in. And what you should get in the very end, so if I kind of show the process, we should get 14,600 divided by 37,875, which will give you a final number of 385 joules grams by Celsius. So I'm just showing the work because I know that some of you like to do the little pieces there, right? So that would be our final answer. Now, what we will do is we'll check it against our chart. And what we're going to see is that, oh, this value 385 that we have matches what we also have for copper up here. So our final answer in this case is going to be copper for the identity of our unknown metal. Okay, so copper. And that is how you can use specific heat to figure out your identity of all your missing components. So these kind of problems, they're usually really straightforward. It's more of a plug and play kind of equations, but you have to be very organized because it's more of a physics problem. So go through it, write down your variables, and keep practicing. Thank you so much for watching. If you like this video, please hit the like and comment button. Please hit that subscribe button too, and I hope to see you here for future videos. Thank you so much for supporting the channel, and I look to see you all in the future. Bye now.